to the Word of God. Go with me to Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3. Praise the Lord. Sister Janice had service this morning here, and she's having different speakers, and this morning she had Christy in. They had themselves a good time, and they come in bragging. And Christy, when you was praying a while ago, you was talking about making jealous. I had the testimony where a mother was talking about one of her sons was serving God, and his wife was serving God, and they were going into ministry together, and they were working together, and so the youngest son was jealous. The youngest son was jealous of his brother, and he didn't tell anybody why he was jealous, but all of a sudden this week he started posting on Facebook scripture and everything. And then he posts, just let everybody know, I am a born-again child of God. Amen? And so everybody say, jealousy will get you in the kingdom. You know, how many of y'all know the devil can't do nothing right? He always overplays his hand. Amen? And so that's the one thing I've always learned. When it looks like he's winning, he always does that one more move that makes him lose. Amen? He always does it. Amen? And that's just the way it works. In Colossians chapter 3, and if I could say this, we're looking at our positioning, but we're also looking at, and when I say position, everybody say positioning in Christ. We're looking at our positioning in Christ, but we're also looking at how to actually mentally accept that positioning. Amen? Because how many of y'all know some people have been in church for 30, 40 years, and they've heard the same word over and over again, and they're still operating just as carnal as somebody that went to a church that don't know anything?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Amen or oh me?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. I mean, it's up to you as to whether you or not you come up hither or not. Mm-hmm. Amen? And there's a lot of people that have heard a lot of good word, but they still are living beneath what God has called them to do. For instance, if you're doing spiritual warfare and you're pointing toward the heavens in battle, you're in the wrong position.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Come on. Why? Because God said your position is set at the right hand of God in heavenly places in Christ Jesus.
Right.
Is that correct?
Yeah.
Then why would you be pointing up? Because you have a revelation, your idea is that the devil's still in a higher place than you. I love this the other day. I mean, y'all know the devil wasn't created in God's class. He was created an angel. He's not created in God's class. He does not have God privileges. Somebody get a hold of that. He doesn't. And so, I don't know, because it's God and the devil. Everybody thinks the devil has some kind of special rights. He doesn't. He was an angel, and he fell, and he's been judged, and he's been condemned. And then God sent Jesus and raised us up and said, you have all authority.
Right. Right.
Where? In heaven and earth. Isn't that powerful? In this particular scripture, it says, if ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affection on the things above and not on the things of earth. For ye are, can anybody read that word? Ye are dead. I notice there's silence. Ye are dead.
Yes.
Everybody say dead.
Yes.
Now listen to me. He's speaking to the body of Christ. He's saying, you're dead. He's talking to disciples. If any man be my disciple, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. Amen? Ye are dead. So he's talking to him. He said, you're dead. Okay? The Apostle Paul said, it's no longer I that liveth, but Christ that liveth in me. Glory to God. It's not me, it's him. And so I've got to change the way I think. Because if I don't have that understanding, then it's always going to be me crying out for God to help me. Right?
Right.
Man, I don't know. Hallelujah. Does it say Baptist out there? Come on, are y'all here? It's okay to talk to me. Listen, God is saying to us this right here. He said we've got to think on the things that are above.
Right.
Amen. We've got to understand that Jesus is set at the right hand of God. That doesn't mean he's set at the right hand personally, because the revelation says he's been given to sit together with his Father in his throne. Amen. Right, what it means right hand is it means that he is in authority.
Right.
Amen. Everybody say, Jesus is in authority. And so, see, we have to come to the place that we mentally accept that.
Right.
Amen?
Yeah.
He is, everybody say, his name is above every name. In heaven, earth, and beneath the earth. Everybody say,
I operate
in his name.
See,
so if you operate in his name and you are still thinking carnal, you're still thinking earthbound, you're still thinking, I'm just an old sinner saved by grace. Now, you're either an old sinner or you got saved by grace.
Amen.
Amen. The blood of Jesus has been applied to your life.
Amen.
Amen. I don't know about you, but I don't get up every morning thinking about what kind of sin I'm going to commit.
No.
Because I have a new consciousness.
Right.
Yeah. Amen. And my new nature doesn't plot to sin. It doesn't plot evil. If it's trying to, I get under deep conviction. Everybody say, Holy Ghost is really good at that. Amen? Hallelujah. Somebody say, you better not mess up. God won't talk to you. Hey, you mess up, he'll talk to you all the time. That's the reason why so many people mess up. The only time they hear him is when they mess up. Come on. They'll tell you they hear God when they mess up, but they can't hear him when they're doing good. Come on, you? God is saying, look, you don't have to mess up to hear me. But you need to begin to think on the things that are above.
Right.
You need to begin to understand who you are. Everybody say, it's a change of mind.
Change of mind.
Say, I've got to change my mind. I'm no longer. See, I was earthbound. But then I got born again. And when I got born again, all the resources of heaven became mine.
Right.
Amen? I'm no longer earthbound anymore.
Right.
Now I have all the access. I have access to come boldly to the throne of grace.
Yeah.
Amen? It's my choice. Hallelujah. So, what happens, how many of y'all know what I'm talking about when you have that bad week? When you have that bad week, you start living under everything. Right? You forget who you are. It's very quick that, I mean, you forget who you are. For instance, if I asked you how long your nose is right now, most of you can't even tell me how long your nose is. I was measuring noses the other day. Had the tape measure out. Did I measure your nose, Terry? Okay, whose nose did I measure? We was in here working, and I pulled the tape measure out. I was measuring noses. I said, man, you got a big one, man. Somebody had a big one. But seriously, we forget. You look in the mirror and don't know what you look like. Somebody said, draw a picture of yourself. You're like, huh? You know, I just don't look that close. Come on. That's what the Bible talks about. That we look at God like that. We look at God and then we walk away and forget what manner of man we are. We look at Jesus and we get into the Word and we begin to see who we are in Christ. And then we walk away and we start forgetting who we are. That's the reason why the body of Christ needs each other. That's why we've got to come together. That's why we've got to be able to encourage and edify and build one another up. It's not to condemn each other.
Right.
Amen. It might be to challenge each other. How many of y'all know it's good to be challenged? I mean, some of the biggest miracles I've ever had is because somebody challenged me. Can I say what they did? They made me mad. You ever had somebody make you mad? And all of a sudden you go, bless God in the name of Jesus. And you stand up. Next thing you know, God does something super. Amen. Hallelujah. So sometimes we need to be challenged because it brings us out of our pit. It brings us out of destruction. It brings us out of bad places. Amen. And I'm challenging you right now. This is what the Word of God is saying. He said it's time for you to think on the things that are above. You're going to have to start thinking on the right things.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Can I tell y'all this? It's not really who likes you here. How many of y'all like to be liked? Mm-hmm. Oh man, I like to be liked. I do. I do. How many of y'all care if you aren't liked? Come on. Most people do care that they're not liked. Amen. Hallelujah. There's some places you want to be liked. Like if you're in Africa and they're mean, you want to be liked. If you're in India and they're going to club you to death, you want to be liked. Amen. There's some places you want to be liked. However, there is a place of walking with God, and if you're pleasing to God, and you know you're pleasing to God, then if somebody doesn't like you, it shouldn't faze you.
Yeah.
Amen? There's a place where you're not in a popularity contest. Everybody say, dead people,
yeah,
don't win popularity contests.
Yeah.
Come on, they don't. And so anyway, there's sometimes that we're not so popular. Amen. A matter of fact, Jesus walked in the midst of some very serious situations, and when he acted out, they didn't like what he was doing until he got the result.
Right.
Amen. That's the reason why he said, you'll know them by their fruit.
Mm-hmm.
Glory to God. So anyway, praise God. We're looking at this scripture. We're not finished. He said, if ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth at the right hand of God. Set your affections on the things above and not on the things of earth, for you are dead, and your life is, what's that word?
Hid.
Thank you. We got somebody that can read 3-letter words there, okay? Hid. Hid. Everybody say, my life is hid. Amen. In Christ. In God. Everybody say the secret place.
Secret place.
Amen. Everybody say I'm hid. Well, you know, no wonder no weapon formed against me to prosper. He can't find me.
Right.
Come on, I'm hid. How am I hid? Everybody say, according to your faith,
according to
be it done unto you.
And
you know, if you're tall, you're wide open, and you're gonna have to deal with it head on. Come on. You don't know you're hid. But Christy and I, we got married, and I looked at her, and I said, I like peace. I keep peace in my home. I like peace in my home. I like peace. I'm a peacemaker. Amen. Hallelujah. It's my nature to be a peacemaker everywhere I go. Amen. When people get around me, and they're all up in a roar, and they're all tormented over something and scared of something, I just keep my peace. Amen. Hallelujah. It bothers me. Amen. It bothers me when somebody messes with me in my peace. Like, what are you doing just sitting there? Aren't you going to do something? I'm like, I am. My peace says I know God's winning. Y'all listen to me. My peace says I know God's winning. Why would I come out of hiding? Why would I come out of hiding to make you feel better? It'd be a whole lot better to rest in this secret place. It'd be a whole lot better. Everybody say rest. What that means is you agree with God above your natural circumstance. Amen. Rest means I get to sleep while everybody else is tormented. Come on. See, that's what happens when you think on the right things. But you have to watch your diet. When I was coming up, y'all, I came up under the best. I mean, I really did. I come up under Copeland and Hagen and Charles Capps and Charles Neiman and Valerie Owen. Y'all don't even know some of these guys, but I come up. I mean, all these guys, Lester Summerall and Shambach and Marilyn Hickey. And, man, I was just, I'm telling you, I love Marilyn Hickey because she taught out of the Old Testament. She was just one of the best teachers I would touch. But I come up under these guys, man, and I was really growing in faith and faith and faith. But how many of y'all know that everybody has a message? Amen? And what happened, there was a whole movement, and it was bringing a revelation of God. Everybody say it was a good word. It was a great word. And it is a great word. Amen? But one day, I remember when God said, I don't want you to listen to them anymore. I said, what? He said, I want you to, actually spoke a certain one, which was my Hebrew. And he said, I don't want you to listen to him anymore. And I said, well, why would you not want me to listen? I'll rebuke you, devil. Come on. And he said, I want to be able to take you where I want to take you. And all of a sudden, I'd be in the pulpit preaching, and I would preach things that I didn't even agree with. How many of y'all ever, I'd be in the pulpit preaching, all of a sudden something would come out of my mouth, and I'd go. And sometimes I would stop, and I'd say, I'm going to tell y'all, that came out of me, but I don't even understand it. I've been in the pulpit and God say prophesy, and I start prophesying things I don't even know about, and I have to go home and research and find out what the heck that was. Because what it was, I had been established in good doctrine, amen, but it wasn't everything. And you know, if you get locked into something and that's all you hear, then all of a sudden you lose out on what everything is.
Amen.
Amen? And so gradually God kept on doing that to me and messing with me until, I thought, man, you know, I can go preach in these churches where I came up under, but I'm not preaching their message anymore. I'm not preaching against their message. I'm just preaching a deeper understanding of their message from a different angle. I remember when God told me, he said, I don't want you to preach faith anymore for right now. I said, God, it's impossible to please you without faith. The just shall live by faith. He said, you don't have to quote scripture to me. Come on. He said, I don't want you to preach on faith for a while. So I went nearly 5 years without preaching a faith message. I promise you, it doesn't matter how many times I preached up till that time, there was never a message I didn't preach faith. Come on. But all of a sudden, God released me in Auburn, Alabama, and he says, I want to give you a message. Hallelujah. Everybody say real faith.
Real faith.
I said, okay. So all of a sudden, he come with this message, and you know what? He changed my whole doctrine on faith. For instance, let me give you a scripture. Romans 10:17. Anybody know that scripture? Everybody say, faith comes by hearing, and hearing, and hearing, and hearing. Okay, well, let's go back and do it again. It says, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Everybody say, by the word of God. Now then, how many of y'all remember all the faith teachers? I'm one. And on their tape series, they had that on their series, faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. So what did we do? We bought every tape they had. Come on, ride down the road, listen to them. I had garbage bags, 30-pound garbage bags full of tapes that were broken because I listened to them so much. Amen? Because I was getting my faith. Faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. The only problem with that is you look over in that scripture, it says faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word there is rhema. Everybody say a living spoken word from God. Now I'm going to mess with y'all just a second. But what did the church do until 400 years ago? 400 years ago is when the Bible actually came into print. And if you ever go get one of those Bibles, I got one in my shelf, you can't even read it. It is the old King James. Now, it was printed And King James had it printed off the scrolls. Are y'all here? But see, the only ones that had access to it, everybody say Roman Catholics. Okay, so they had set up their own system. How many of y'all know that wasn't exactly scriptural? But see, they told their people they didn't need to hear the Bible, they just need their priest. Right? That's a powerful move that's been going on the last 100, 200 years, right? But how in the world did people survive without hearing all these tapes and CDs and going on YouTube? How'd they survive without the TV preacher? How'd they survive without all the teachers? How'd the church survive 1,600 years? Amen? Everybody say relationship. Say that's what's going on in China. In China, the church is growing, and it used to be 30,000 people a day. They say it's more than that now. 1 in 10 of them have a Bible. They take a page and tear it out and let people read it, and they pass it around. And yet, those people can have a meeting, and they don't get to tell anybody what time the meeting is or where the meeting is, because they can be killed for going to that meeting. They can be thrown into prison. They can be beaten for going to that meeting. And yet these people show up at the meeting right on time. Are y'all here? Why? Because they went into the relationship. There's going to be a lot of people shocked when they find out that God is not a CD. They're going to be shocked when they find out that God is not a book.
Yes.
Come on. Everybody say, He has exalted His word above His name. I'm not coming against the book. I teach out of the book. Amen? We have a Bible college and we're teaching the book. But what am I saying to you? I'm saying to you, it's about relationship. So you got to begin to change your mind on how you think. Because even the way we've been trained to go after God, a lot of it is wrong. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 6, He says, "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and all His righteousness, and all these things will be added to you." He didn't say read the book of John. Now listen to me. What is it? Everybody say the kingdom of God is not in meat or drink, but righteousness, joy, and peace in the Holy Ghost. Is that right? And so all of a sudden, inside the Holy Ghost is a kingdom. Right? Everybody say the kingdom's in me. That's what He said. He said when they say, "Lo, it's over here, lo, it's over there," believe it not, for the kingdom of God is in you. Everybody say, seek first the kingdom. Why am I going after the kingdom? Because in the kingdom is my place of fellowship with the, everybody say, with the living God. Amen? So God says, if you'll come in here and fellowship with me, now that you're born again, we can walk and talk. Amen? Hallelujah. But through years, people have used the book to make God appear and almost inaccessible. That maybe one day He might come down and answer a prayer for you if He's not too busy. And God said, I'm not that God. I'm the God that loved you so much that I moved into you. I'm living in you. You're my tabernacle. You're my temple. Amen? It's powerful when you get into this. And so we have to change the way we're thinking. So think on the things that are above. The scripture's full of it. Hallelujah. It's exciting. All right, I'm going to flip the scripture just a second because we just need to go somewhere else. Go with me over to John, 1 John, chapter 4. 1 John, chapter 4. See, we get into things like our priesthood. I love what it says. You're a chosen generation, a holy nation, a peculiar people. Amen? You're a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people who show forth the praises of Him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, who were not a people and now are a people. How many of y'all, that described you? Amen. Everybody say a royal priesthood. You remember when the scripture says the kings of the earth shall bow down? For years and years and years, even in my spirit-filled walk, I was just waiting on the kings of the earth to bow down. But then I realized we're a royal priesthood. And every time we worship God, we're bowing down before Him. Isn't that powerful? Hallelujah. Before He had Levitical priests, which were carnal, and only one a year could go into His presence. Now He's got a priesthood that is filled with Him. Glory to God. See, those are things that we need to be thinking of. All I'm doing is challenging your thinking tonight. Because when we go into the things that we're talking about going into, you have to know who you are. You have to be able to identify with what God is doing in you. Hallelujah. I'm just telling you, it's powerful to watch God heal people. Amen? Watch God deliver people. Very quickly, deliver people. It's not hard. It's not complicated. It's very easy. Amen? All right, look here in the scripture. I guess we'll start in verse 17. 1 John chapter 4, verse 17. Herein is our love made perfect. Look at verse 12 now. No man has seen God any time. If we love one another, God dwelleth in us, and His love is what? Everybody say, you can have perfected love. Right? Isn't that great? Everybody say, it's not mine, it's His. Everybody say, I give my unperfected, and He gives me His perfected. What does that mean? That means all of a sudden you want to love people the way God does. That's powerful. You did that when you first got saved. Y'all remember that? You remember how you just thought, wow, man, if God saved me, He can save anybody. You know, you'd hear somebody start picking on somebody and go, I can't believe that. God, don't let them, don't let them get hurt, you know. You defend them. Hallelujah. That's perfect love. It says, herein is our love made perfect, that we have may have boldness in the day of judgment. Because as He is, so are we in this world. Everybody say, as He is, so are we in this world. How many of y'all realize that if His perfected love is manifest in you, then you are as He is? Because God is love. Right? So all of a sudden I'm loving you with my love, but it's not good enough. So God said, wow, I'm appreciating your effort. So I'm going to show up in love through you with my love. And all of a sudden, man, I look at you and I love you past knowledge. I love you past everything. I love it just like for God so loved the world. He looked at the world, it was a mess. But you know what? He loved us past knowledge and sent Jesus for us. Isn't that powerful?
Yes.
And all of a sudden, I'm not looking at people and deciding whether they're good enough or not for me to minister to. Right? Because I'm able to love them past what I know about them. And that way I can reach them, because nobody in the eyes of God is unlovable. You don't know how mean they are. Those mean people end up being the best preachers in the world. Amen. They'll go anywhere.
Yeah.
They'll get people out of pits of hell and drag them out, man. I'm telling you. Hallelujah. So, you know, it doesn't matter how mean they are. It doesn't matter how bad they are. All that is irrelevant.
Right.
Amen. Then I get into the church. And I find out this is a place to grow. And everybody's in different places. And the only way we can do that is to love past knowledge. So I need His love for you, because I know you're messing. Come on. I know you're slipping. I know you're having weaknesses. I know you're having the bad days. Come on. And it doesn't matter. Because God loves you past that. And He's living in you despite all that. Amen. He takes you through all your bad attitudes and all your bad decisions, and He's right there with you just waiting on you to come back into truth.
Amen.
Wow. Isn't God good?
Yes.
So He says this, herein is our love made perfect, boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. Look at this. There is no fear in love.
Amen.
But perfect love casts out fear, because fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. So you say, well, how do I know I'm perfect in love? Well, is there any fear there? What are you afraid of? Are you afraid to die? Come on, are you here? What are you afraid of? You're afraid somebody's going to not like you? If you're afraid of those things, you're not perfect in love. The minute all of a sudden you just love everybody and you're willing to lay down your life. Amen. That's perfect love. Amen. Glory to God. Everybody say, I get to do that here. That's so powerful. See, but this is thinking on things that are above. We've got to learn to do that. It doesn't happen because you come into a church service and hear a good sermon. It doesn't just happen, come on, because you're getting one good praise service. It doesn't happen if you have a week of praise services. Can I tell you the disillusionment of most ministers and people throughout the world? Is they can remember all the wonderful conferences they've gone to and all the times that God had them this high. And all of a sudden, it's not like that today. And they're saying, wait, I got all this truth. I confessed all this truth. I spoke all this truth. I preached all this truth. I saw miracles happen, but my life is not adding up to what I have been taught. Are y'all here? Why? Because it's not good enough just to hear it. You've got to hear it from him. You've got to walk in a relationship where it's between you and him. Peter said, Jesus said, whom men say thou the Son of Man am? He said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. That's what Peter said after all the others. And Jesus said, blessed are you, by Simon Bar-Jonah. Flesh and blood have not revealed it to you. You know what Jesus said? I'm flesh and blood. You didn't get that from me. He said, you've heard from my Father, which is in heaven. And upon this rock,
Lord, yes.
I'll build my church, yes. And the gates of hell will not prevail against it. See, your walk is not going to be built on who you listen to on CD or who you listen to in the pulpit.
Right.
That's the reason why it's called the foolishness of preaching. Because most of y'all won't even know what I preach when you walk out the door. Right now, I'm just preaching so that you might hear something from God while I'm preaching. Because the only thing you're going to know is what God tells you. Amen. You say, boy, that was really a good sermon. You know, but the only thing you're going to walk out of here is what God tells you in the middle of it. That's what happens in praise and worship. You get a praise and worship service. It's wonderful. It's valuable. Amen. But it's really just an atmosphere for God to talk to you. That's what intercessory prayer is. When you begin to pray and you begin to intercede, all you're doing is setting an atmosphere for God to talk to you. You are not going to be transformed by the intercessory prayer. You're not going to be transformed by the worship alone. You're not going to be transformed because you heard a good sermon. You're going to be transformed when you start hearing God yourself. And you do that from the very beginning of your salvation. The Bible says, except the Father draw men, he cannot be saved.
Right.
So guess who you heard when you got born again? Did it work? Did it change you? It changed you so much you're still sitting here saying, God, I know I'm going to get this right one day. Amen? It changed you so much it made giving up your Sunday nights or your Sunday mornings or your whatevers. Some of you know what it is to give up your life. Amen? It changed you. God speaking to you changed you. Say, I don't know how in the world they do those mission trips. God spoke to them. It changed them. They go on there, they can be miserable while they're doing it even. But they'll be ready to go again while they're leaving. Because God has spoken, God has given them something and changed them. That's why you've got to think on things above. It can't be about how so-and-so walks. It can't be about how so-and-so does it. It can't, come on. Everybody, every church has a ceiling. They all have siblings. I wish ours didn't. You know, I would love to think that anything God wanted to do would happen here. Amen? As a matter of fact, I'd love to experience anything he wants to do here. Amen? But how many of y'all know, even if the minister doesn't have a ceiling, that the church will put a ceiling? You'll put a ceiling. You know, it's like, wow, this is a lot more than I'm used to. I'm not used to this. And what are you doing? Immediately, you're sitting there thinking about what you're used to, and so you're trying to hold things into that pattern. Yeah. It's funny, you leave a church because you're dissatisfied with it, and you come to another church and then try to change it in the church you're just satisfied with. Isn't that amazing? No, you got to learn how to grow from faith to faith, from glory to glory. Y'all understand? We got to learn. I mean, God uses steps, stepping stones to deal with different areas in our life. Right. And so if God has you around here right now, he's got you around here to do something in you, amen? And it was probably something he couldn't do somewhere else.
Right.
So you got to receive it. You got to let it happen.
Right.
Everybody say, we're not going to get the all in all here.
Well,
I want everything I can get here. I want it to be the all in all. But I can't make that happen. The only ones that make that happen is you guys. Right? I can take the chains off and say, hey, fellowship, connect. Amen? Hallelujah. Conflict. Love each other through it. I mean, y'all know what I want to talk about. Everybody say conflict.
Conflict.
Love through it.
Love through
everybody
it.
Say maturity.
Maturity.
Say those things help.
Right.
And somebody said, man, I don't want to go to church because there's just too many problems there. Well, you're sitting at home dying.
Mm-hmm.
So, well, I'm watching TV.
Mm-hmm.
Hallelujah. So, you know, I go to these churches and they just ain't got the revelation I got. Well, if you got so much revelation, why don't you have a love for the body that you would go and pour and minister to?
Right.
I mean, you got to get rid of all that stinking thinking. And you've got to begin to think on those things that are above.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. And that's what God's saying. He said, come on and begin to think on the things that are above. Amen? See, I can cause you to be as I am right now in the earth. Everybody say that'd be like Jesus. Because that was what Jesus was. He was the Father. When he said, when you've seen me, you've seen the Father.
Amen.
Amen? I and my Father are one. Jesus said, my Father worketh therefore I work. I only do the things I see my Father do. I only say the things I hear my Father say. Hallelujah. Somebody say love.
Love.
Everybody say perfected love.
Perfected love.
Can do that.
Can do that.
You know why? Because the Bible says faith worketh by love. Amen. Everybody say my faith will work. Because I'm rooted and grounded in love. So, all right, so here we are. We're trying to come up here. We're trying to change our mind. Amen. And you're going to go home. And somebody's going to call you on the phone. And they're going to remind you that you are earthbound, even though you're not. And you're going to get to respond to what you're hearing on the phone. Amen? And it's going to determine whether God is involved in your situation or whether you're trying to fix it. Amen? It's the truth. It is the truth. My goodness. All right, we got one more passage of scripture I want to take you to. These are the scripture God told me to go to. I said, man, I don't quite understand the order of this, but I'm going to do it. Amen? And it's in Ephesians chapter 1. Hallelujah. Think about the good things God has done. Think about the victories you have won. Don't think about the times you were down and out. Think about how God brought you out. Think about the sweet, sweet Spirit of God way down in your soul.
Yes.
Isn't that great? I love it. I love it. Ephesians chapter 1. Hallelujah. Start in verse, well, let's let's just go all the way to verse 15. He said, "Wherefore, I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus, and love unto all the saints." Everybody say, "And love unto all the saints." So they got a report of loving each other. Wow. He says, "Cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him." Now, when it says knowledge there, it is not talking about knowing about. It's talking about an intimate knowing God. Amen? So he's praying. He's saying, "I'm praying that you're going to intimately know God, that God would move in that way for you." Powerful. He says, "That the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, and what is the riches of the glory of the inheritance in the saints." Everybody say, "His riches of glory in the inheritance of the saints." Everybody say, "God has riches of glory." Everybody say, "It's us." That's what he's saying. He's saying that. That's just so incredible. And he says, "What is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead." Everybody say, "The same power that raised Jesus from the dead has been sent to me and is at work in me." Amen. Glory to God. "That he wrought in Christ, and he raised him from the dead, and set him at his own right hand in heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion, and every name that was named, not only in this world, but also in the world which is to come." Amen. "And hath put all things under his feet, and gave him to be the head over all things to the church." Everybody say, "Which is his body?" Everybody say, "I am the Lord's body." Amen? Hallelujah. Now, I have to go back to this. It says, "And hath put all things under his feet." Now, are the feet in the head or in the body? Everybody say, "Under his feet." Everybody say, "That would be my feet, because I'm the body." You remember what Jesus said to the disciples in Luke chapter 10? He said, "Ye shall tread on serpents and scorpions, and nothing by any means shall hurt you." Amen? Everybody say, "He put it under our feet." Oh, man, look at that. "And he hath put all things under his feet, and gave him to be the head over the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all." Everybody say, "The fullness of him." I want you to understand this. You've been bought with a price. You're no longer your own. You are now the tabernacle of God, not filled with earthly hands. Amen? Yes. You're not a tabernacle that man could build. You were built by God. Amen? Everybody say, "I'm God's house. I'm his tabernacle." Yes. Amen? Yes. Now listen to this. He said, "In the earth," everybody say, "the fullness of him all in all." How many of you are one with Christ Jesus? Yes. Hallelujah. You cannot have fullness of God anymore without the body of Christ involved. Yes. Amen? That's the reason why he said the fullness of him, amen, all in all. What's the importance of that? How many of y'all pray? Why do you pray? I mean, let's just say God's just going to do anything he wants to anyway, so why pray? Huh? Why do you pray? Why do you speak to things? Why do you release things? Why do you ask God for things? Because in the earth, you have authority. And Psalms 115, verse 15, 16, it says, Lord created the heavens and the earth. The heavens, even the heavens are the Lord's, but the earth has he given to the children of men. Jesus had to come and take the earth back as a man. And then he left, and everybody say, I'm still in the earth. And so that's why he's working through us. Come on. Somebody said, well, why is the earth in such a mess? Because the church don't know that. Amen. The church doesn't understand the authority that we've been given. We don't understand, and I'm being honest with you, I want you to know, we still don't understand. We're trying to get a grip. We're trying to grab hold of this thing. Amen. But I mean, every once in a while we get a hold of it, and there's some great victory that takes place. But what if all of a sudden we change the way we thought? What if we begin to think on those things that are above? Mm-hmm. We begin to think on our new identity in Christ Jesus. We begin to see ourselves, hallelujah, as one in Christ, as the fullness of God in the earth, because in me is Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, and they're working through me. That's what Paul said. It's no longer I that liveth, but Christ that liveth in me. Amen? And so that's what's going on. What if all of a sudden I get a clue that I'm working from the throne and that everything's under my feet with him? Not by myself, but in him.
Right.
Amen? What if I get a clue about being hid in him? Amen. The secret place is real. It truly does exist.
Right.
Most of the church has never found it. Amen? They never found it. But if you find it, it is a place of rest. It's a place of peace. It's a place where God moves when you just think it. You think a prayer. You think, you know, you're riding down the road, and all of a sudden I was riding down the road in a community one day, and over here in South Knoxville, well, West Knoxville. It's outside of Knoxville. And I was in the community preaching. I said, man, what a nice community. I said, God, I'd love to have some land out here. I just said it. Just said it. One day I get a phone call. Somebody says, how would you like to have some land out here? I said, I'd love that. They said, well, somebody wants to give away 2 lots. You want me to tell them to give it to you? I said, yes, I would. So this somebody that I never met sent me 2 deeds signed for land in that community. I just said, boy, God, I'd like to have some land out here. I told God one day, I said, God, it's time for another car. Right? It is time for another car. I mean, this car, thank you, God. I know that the children's clothes are not wear out in the wilderness no matter what, but you know, 350,000 miles on this thing. It's time for a new car, God. I didn't do nothing else. But about 30 days later, somebody walked up and said, God told me to give you this car. Thank you. See, that's what happens when you know your identity and you know where you're at. It's not a works. You don't have to work yourself. You come into this place of knowing, amen? God told me one day, he said, stop confessing and start possessing. I said, God, what are you saying to me? Because everything I preach was confessed. Amen? That's a message. Because we're trying to get everybody say, change your mind. Amen. I'm going to tell you how to change your mind. Because all that word, it didn't matter how much scripture I had in me, when everything's falling apart, I was still crying. Come on. The only way you change your mind is come into an intimate relationship with God and allow him to speak. It will transform you. Everybody say, give me this day my daily bread. Now, who are you asking to talk to? You're asking the Father that gives rocks at the gates of hell. Because he said, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Father, talk to me every day. I need a rock for today.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen?
And so God speaks the rock. Man, you get used to getting them rocks and believing them. You get used to just traveling through life not worried about nothing. All of a sudden, you start seeing the transformation. You see the transformation not only of you, but you start seeing the transformation of your family. You start seeing the transformation of the place you work. You start seeing the transformation of your friends. Everything starts from, everybody say, I am the eye in the middle of the storm. If I keep my peace, the storm will lay down. Come on. Because that peace is the most powerful thing in that storm. Amen? Glory to God. You have that ability. You have that power. God told me one day, he said, you're my God bomb. I said, you're God bomb. He said, yeah, I drop you off in dark places and command you to shine. Amen. Instead of being dropped off in dark places and saying, oh, I must really miss God. Pray me out of this, everybody. No, God says, hey, I put you there to shine. 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 Let there be light. I'm about through preaching now. Amen. I know I unloaded a lot, but y'all get the picture. The only thing I want you to get out of this, it's time to change your identity, and it's time for you to start thinking out of who you are. Everybody say, that which is born of spirit is spirit. That which is born of flesh is flesh. Everybody say, as a spirit, I can sit at the right hand of God in heavenly places. As a spirit, I can tread on serpents and scorpions, and nothing by any means hurt me. As a spirit, I can release the miracles of God and all the blessings of heaven to those around me. Amen. Hallelujah. So we've got to learn to think on those things of above. Stand your feet. Glory unto God. So excited. Hallelujah. Now, in just a minute, we're going to have worship. But before that, I want to pray this prayer. And all I want to do, I'm just trying to get this to stick in you. Because, you know, when we go back out the door, there'll be things that tell you, it'll cause you to even forget what you learned here tonight. By the time you get to the restaurant and somebody asks you what I preach, you'll go, oh, it was a great message. What was that? Come on. But every one of you will know something. Because watch this. How many of you, God spoke something to you tonight while I was preaching? God showed you something. Raise your hand up high. Look at that. Then I have accomplished my purpose.
Yes, yes.
Because my purpose is not, I can't carry you into heaven with me. I can't carry you into the blessing. But I'm telling you, if I can connect you to Him, you're going to be transformed. If I had you name my message tonight, there'd be 20 different names for this message. Maybe 40. Amen. I want you to lift your hands. Say, Father God,
thank you
for moving into my life and transforming me, changing me. By your grace, your ability to do what I can't do myself, I am choosing to think on the things that are above. I'm choosing to come into a love walk that as you are, I will be in this world. Father God, I'm choosing to become your fullness in the earth. So Father, in the name of Jesus, I welcome the fellowship. I welcome the word of the Lord. Father, I give you praise for Jesus Christ, who leads me out. I give you praise for the Holy Spirit, who guides me in. But But I give you praise.
I give you praise.
That you give me rocks.
That you give me rocks.
Every day.
Every day.
That I have victory.
That I have victory.
Over all the works of the enemy.
Over all the works of the enemy.
In Jesus' name. Somebody say amen.
Woo!
Amen. Glory unto God. Glory unto God. Wow. Wow. Hallelujah. Amen.